Okay, good evening everyone. Thank you for being here and welcome. So as you may not know, this is the first event from Forum by Confluence, which is an event organized by the students, for the students. So from there, from this initiative, we invite any of you that have any more ideas or who's willing to participate to come and join us for that. So the idea of having this forum is to activate a space within the school in which we can organize conferences, host guests, and have some discussions, debates, or exhibitions.
So our pleasure to introduce Odile Decq as our first guest. We thought it would be a nice way to kick things off, seeing as she's the reason why we're here in the first place. I think we're all familiar with her work, but it would be rude not to mention the many awards that she's won for her contributions to the field of architecture, including the Golden Lion in Architecture, the Venice Biennale 96, the 2017 Architizer Lifetime Achievement Award, and recently the Art National du Mérite, or just last year. So yes, thank you very much for being here tonight, and I think I'll let you take it
away.
Thank you, Gina and Michelle.
As you may know, all the students of the school, that architecture thinking is my theme forever, but I think that architecture is really powerful, much more than we believe usually, because usually architecture is seen as a profession, as a way of organizing, building, designing buildings, etc. But I strongly believe that it's more than that, it's a culture, it's a discipline that can help the world, and this is why I think that architecture thinking, which is the way to think, the way to design, and the way to propose and to build is a process that could be applied to not only on building, but also on everything that we, for helping people to live better. So, in my career, from the very beginning, I was always interested with art, and not only by architecture, so I tried to mix all the time and to do, at the same time, art, architecture, design, etc. So, I start by showing you some art installation, such like that. This is one of the first ones that I did in New York 2004. It was in an art gallery where they asked me to present something, and they said, we don't want you to present architecture, we want you to do something in the space. So I built a space, which is a kind of a cabinet. And this cabinet is not regular. The walls are not vertical. They are covered, half of the walls inside are covered by mirrors, the other one painted in white. And on the white one, I was projecting images of my project, but part of the images. And because it was with a mirror walls in the other side, because nothing was totally irregular, it was creating new spaces. Because the space that you see, you look at in between these two, is not in the space. It's something that comes from the outside. And this is a way to distract and to deconstruct the space. And the floor was not horizontal, it was on the slope. And this, I call that virtual space in real. And I present that because Aldo told me that he heard about that piece. And so for a long time ago, I was doing this little sketch to the people in the office to explain what is a dynamic equilibrium. For me, that equilibrium, you know, all of you, that could be reached with a beam on two columns, it's static. But if you put only one column, you have to establish and to calculate and to estimate where is the equilibrium. And mostly when you have a big part and a small part. So you have to make that balancing and to have to reach the point of equilibrium. So I decided what the gallery, which is here on the Rue de Musée, asked me to be the first one presented after renovating the space. He said, Odile, you will be the first exhibited in the space. And I said, okay, I can build that in real, in three dimensions. So these are two balls, two balloons. This big one is as a air balloon, and this one is a ball of an aluminium filled with sand. And the beam is 6 meters long. It's a little section of 3x3. And the column is a little section of aluminium 3x3. So to know what is the point, where is the point, I asked the engineer to calculate. And it was precise and unprecise, but not totally. But we built it like that. And this balloon is 2 meters diameter, is filling the space. And on this other side is the laser. So to fill that, we fill the space. First, put the balloon, and after that, put the other balloon, and fill the sun at the end, grain by grain, to reach equilibrium. And this is just one above each other. This is not attached. So when you are, when we were, you were very sensible, your mouth. Okay. So the balloon is filling the space. And because it's filling the space in on the B side are very tight. So when you were walking on the B side, and it's not touching anything, not the ceiling, the floor, and the wall. When you are passing on the B side, you are moving the air. And because that, the balloon started to move a little bit. So you knew that this this equilibrium is unstable, or at the limit of stability. So this question of instability, stability, and dynamics is really my work. And the other one is, the other one is very static, and more static because it's balanced with the other one, and for 6 meters distance. And in France, we have the Festival of Garden in Chambon-sur-Loire. And in 2009, they started, every year they do a thematic. And in 2009, the thematic was color. And in the office, we decided to propose a black garden. And because artists, art designers, architects can propose something for this garden, and we are selected. So we have been selected with that garden, which is not a garden. It's a kind of a garden, in a way. So this is a collection of glass sheets, black, without mirror inside, just black. The space in the center is filled with tire powder with a big thickness of 15 centimeters. And in the middle, there is a little surface of water on a black surface. So this is the black garden. And at the same time, this is the black hole, the kind of a representation of the black hole. And I'm totally fascinated by the black hole in the space. So, and thanks to this black sheets of glass, the space was playing with the sun, and the sun was playing with the sheets of glass, and transforming the perception of the space. And because of this tire powder surface on the floor, all the suns were absorbed. So in the gardens around, everybody was playing with gardens all around, with flowers, colors, etc. In this garden, which was totally dark, it was totally silencious, because we couldn't talk to a person on the opposite of the garden, of my garden. We couldn't hear the other person because the sound was absorbed by the floor. It was a silencious place in the middle of a chaotic collection of flowers and colors. Again, in the same gallery, close to here, he asked me in 2011 to do something else. And I proposed, and I told him that collectors who are coming in galleries, usually they know the space. They are very used to come, and they know the space. So by inserting some mirrors, black mirrors and normal mirrors, at certain position into the space, I want to disturb the perception of the space, to perturb the perception of the space, and to give the people the impression that the space is different now. So these are some mirrors installed into the space to change the perception of the space as the way they were planning or going into the space. The space, if you go there, is very rectangular, it's normal, but with that mirror, it was really perceived as something else. And in Louis Vuitton, the headquarters of the shop on Champs-Élysées, before the construction of the Louis Vuitton Foundation in the Quadrilat, they had a space on the top floor of their building, And it was, when I came there, and they asked me to come and to do something on the terrace. I went there, and I opened the windows, and I discovered that, you know that Paris is a flat cake. Paris, if you go to the Triomphe and you go and you have an overview about Paris, you discover that everything has the same height, everywhere. This is a flat cake for me. And only the avenues and the boulevard cutting this flat cake. But in that building, there is one floor which is going above the regular height of all the buildings around. And this is that space, that place. And I decided to do a kind of a jump, the possibility to go and to jump, to fly over Paris. So this is a ramp. And the ramp, when you don't care, you have the impression that you go directly to the parapet, but you have space in it before. And the limit on both sides are sheets of glass. And this sheet of glass was covered with a film, a three-dimensional film, that transforms the perception of what you see again. When you were going straight on, the both sides were translucent, and you don't see it through. But as soon as you turn your head and you look perpendicular to the glass, you can look through. Like that. Thanks to this three-dimensional film under the glass. So you see other buildings, but also you see that the terrace has both sides and you can go there. This is not dangerous to go just flying over Paris. In the FIAC, in 2010, another gallerist asked me to build something and to build that will be presented in the museum, of, in the garden of the Museum of Natural History in Paris. And I built an atom, what did I call an atom. And for me, the atom, if I use the different letters in French, this is abri temporaire pour oiseaux migrateurs. That means temporary space for migratory birds. Because at this time, the president of the time was totally against the fact that students and people were coming. It was a question of with the migration. And I was saying that even so now people can't stay in Paris or can't come and stay in France. Maybe the birds, migratory birds are flying above Paris, I can provide for them a place to stay. But this place to stay is very temporary because there are two holes into that. So they can come in, but they immediately fly somewhere else. And it was a question of a kind of a statement in front of the president was always saying that you can stay, migrants have to pass by. And the Prime Minister said, and I told you, this is it. So in SIARC, they asked me, they have an exhibition space, and every year they organize two, three exhibitions, and very often they ask architects to come and to propose something for their exhibition space. And they asked me to come, and instead of building an object, I rebuilt a space inside. And this space is built with these four triangles equilateral, which are totally regular. But again, I play the same game than with the first installation that I showed, with the partition that are not vertical and covered inside all by mirror. And the passage in between are not at the same place. So when you were looking to the space, it's like that. So, and it's inclined because all the partitions are inclined. Inside, you don't understand where you are. Because everything is mirror. And it's totally, and it's not vertical. So they are reflecting all the other worlds without understanding where you are. And sometimes you can believe that there is a passage there, but it's not. This is just a reflection of the fact of the passage on the other side. Playing with that. Things of mirror, changing the perception of the space again, it's something that I'm really interested by. You don't see where is the limit between the floor and not totally and the walls, but you don't know if it's that one, because everything was reflected and not vertical, so you don't understand in which kind of place you are. And in Milan, every year, at the Salon des Mobiliers, in one of the universities in the center of Milan, the magazine internally asked and called some architect designer again to build something with a contractor or something with a material company or whatever. So they asked me to build something with tiles. And this company, Fion, was tiles, at this time was showing off their big tiles, 3 meters long, 1 meter large, and 3 millimeters of 6 millimeters thin. That is very little, very thin and fragile one. And they wanted to that I do something with that. So they were thinking that I will build a space covered with the tiles extra. But what was interesting me is it's a section of the tiles, the fragility of the tiles. So I decided to put the tiles vertically, to join them by steel beams, a kind of bar, and to create a cube. But this cube is perforated by the volume that if a ball was crossing the cube and creating a space inside. And you could have walked inside, walking on the section of the tiles, of these 3 millimeters, section of the tiles. It was delicate, but it was possible. Okay. And in Venice, last year, in the Biennale, the Architecture Biennale, the curator asked me to present the restaurant that I did in the Opéra Garnier in Paris. Now I will not present you this restaurant because it has been destroyed. So I can't show you, I don't want to show you because I will destroy. So I decided not to present that as a model, that all the architects, the other architects are presenting models or objects like that. I decided to recreate the perception of the space. So the perception of the space is really built by the sinuous glass, because we have sinuous facade, sinuous glass facade, behind the restaurant. We have a red carpet, we have a mezzanine, which is red, and we did one wall with the sinuous glass, asking a company to provide us the glass, which is with a specific treatment that is totally reflective, even if it's black and reflective. On both sides, we did big photos of the space. The ceiling is, representing in a way, the surface of the restaurant, and you could sit. And on the other side, the glass was totally straight on, so it's reflecting on both extremities, and each other. So people could pass by, sit, and rest. And you go to the building and then like that, yes, I will provide you for you to see because it's a right. So,
I do architecture.
So, the first project I will do very fast because this is one of my first well-known projects, which is the Banque Populaire de l'Ouest in Rennes in 1990. So that means 30 years ago. And this is a big, long building with a glass facade facing south. And at this time, it was the beginning of the glass facade. And it was the fact that I wanted to demonstrate that with glass facade, you can even face south and treat that with the comfort inside. And it's a suspended glass facade, so I will explain you the technique, because this is very important. So all this surface of glass is suspended from the top. There is a beam into the hall here, and into all the way to the building, and all the glass is suspended to that. That means the first sheet of glass, 2 meters by 2 meters, is suspended, attached to the beam. The second is suspended to that, the third to the second, and the fourth to the third. And so this is like a sheet of paper. You are suspended a glass, it's like a sheet of paper. We can move because there is wind. So because of this wind, by deporting a structure in front, having inside this structure sunscreens, I procure shadow on the glass. And with doing that, because it's 2 meters difference, the distance is 2 meters, I created a gallery in front of the facade for people passing by, having under the shadow during the summer. And this structure itself is totally suspended. because this is 12 meters and the tube is 12 centimeters. So if you take a tube of 12 meters, if you put it like that on two supports, it will fall immediately, it will curve. So everything is suspended to this three-dimensional beam on the top, on the columns, and all the beams are resuspended to that and to the floor. So by this tension in between the cable, every 2 meters, the beams are horizontal. And this is a kind of, what can I say, solar system of protecting the cable, very traditional. Because if you think about the, I was, my reference at this time was the Venice San Marco Square, where you can pass by under the arcade during the summer, even though we are facing south, because there are some textiles that they suspend in front of the arcade, and you can walk there, and it's fresh. Because when you have a very short distance between the sun and the shadow, there is a little wind. And the wind that I provide here is refreshing the glass from the outside. So this is totally transparent glass, not treated, because at this time we are not working a lot with treatment of glass, but especially because I didn't want to have reflective glass. Because the solution that everybody was using at this time was using reflective glass, to reflect the glass, the sun. And I hate that. I wanted to have the transparency of the glass. So this part is a suspended glass facade, single glass. It was the second time in the world to do that. The first time was with Peter, because it was with Peter Rice that I worked. And Peter Rice is one of the greatest engineers from the 20th century, but he died in 1995. And he invented the suspended glass. And he did that for the first time in the greenhouse in La Villette, in Paris. And this is the engineer who invented how to make the structure of the building in Pompidou Center. And he started his career by doing the cover of the opera house in Sydney. So he was really a great engineer. So I met him, and I showed him my building and my project, and he said, okay, I have done already the one single glass suspended, but I want to do that in double glass. So he said, I wish you, I will do the double glass. So all the half of this half of the building is a double glass suspended facade with the same system. And it's how we developed the system of suspension. It's on this building. It was the first time in the world to do that. So it was very interesting to work with him. And one of the person that is coming to the school, Gaëtan Coller, and you were not there, who will work with you about the structure of your project. He's working with Udeton in the office of Udeton. Maybe you heard about him, no? And Udeton was my correspondent working with Peter Rice, because he was working with Peter Rice. So this person, Udeton, I knew him from this time. And he was really, he's an architect, but he was working the same work that I'm doing to him. And working with Peter Rice was at the first time when I presented him in my building, in my project, he was not asking me how do I want to do to this explore. He said, how do you want to provide the light into your building? So it was really thinking and trying to resolve the question of lighting, the question of bringing the light into the building. And we had a long discussion about the kind of structure that we can have in front of the facade. But doing that, having the structure outside of the building, and I had the space for doing it, on the interior, it's just a glass surface. So thanks to that, if they want to do partition, the partition we are going directly to the glass without having structure. And even it was suspended. Because today, if you look at the suspended glass that you can find anywhere, there are cables, everything on the interior. This one will transfer everything outside. So in the night, the light is in the gallery and the light is lighting on the structure. And this is the way I started to develop lighting for buildings, because I was working a lot with the lighting, because I love how to do my lighting for my building. And this, I have to do it. So you see the screens that are suspended into the structure, and they are directed by anemometer and by solar cells. So as soon as there are too much sun, they go down. But if there are too much wind, they go up. And we didn't put the sunscreen at the first frame because I wanted to show that this is the entrance place. Because when you have a total homogeneous facade, you don't know where is the entrance. And so the entrance is like that. This is the outside. You have the glass, and this is the door entrance, under the gallery. But you don't know precisely where is the surface of the glass and where is the structure because of the reflection, because when you're on the B side of the facade, the glass becomes reflected. And it's reflecting the structure and gives density of passage. Because we are in the countryside, in front of the buildings, there are fields, cows, a little river, etc. So this is the way that I wanted to create a transition between the outside and the inside. As soon as you pass the sheet of glass, which is 12 millimeters thick, you enter into the main hall, which is 100 square meters. But this main hall is 50 meters long. And it's limited by a curved wall. At every extremity, this is 0 centimeter. And in the center, this is 4 meters. So it's the space. So entering at one extremity, that means going in front of the wall, the back wall. So when you are passing the door, and starting to turn your body and to walk all the space to go to the other part, to cross the wall. So it's a dynamic space to create a long transition between the countryside and the place where people were working. So this is how to transform space, and this wall, if I want to explain, I think we will pass the light. So this wall is composed by brick, aluminum bricks that we invented for this project. It's even the floors are made, we designed everything on this project. And it was done in two years, one in February 88 and finished and delivered in January 90, 2 weeks. It was day and night. Really dense project. And this is bricks, this is aluminum bricks. I did not know, we invented a lot of way of building this big wall that we wanted in steel. But at the end, we came to the solution of having bricks. 6 meters long bricks with a profile, which was 30 centimeters high and 6 centimeters large. And inside, there is a little register or something which is making it rectangular. But they built the bricks, they painted them, they erected them, and after that they rolled it. And because they were curved in them, and we had this little register inside, the register is making a bit of a vibration. So when they started to build it, somebody from the company called me and said, and called me immediately from Rennes, and said, you know, this is not vertical, this is not smooth, this is not totally flat, as it must be. So I said, send me a photo and I will come. At this time, we did not have internet, we did not have all of that. So it was really, and I will come not with TGV, because at this time it was not TGV, so I had to come to the after. And I went there and I said, oh, this is like if we have a film of water running on that. So I like it. I like the effect, so we keep it. So to tell you that sometimes there are some reasons that you don't totally predicted. And you don't know precisely what you have an intention, you do all the work to build it, but at the end the result is a bit different and you have to understand if you keep it or not. And how it gives you a better effect than what you want. And you have this vibration of the wall, you have the reflection of the and the shadows of everything, so the space becomes something else. It's not just long space. Okay. So this is a way to transit through the space. So I will go faster. I want this competition because I want to explain it because at the beginning I did not want to show you, but I am now aware I can explain that. This is the viaduct and the control center. And the control center is suspended into the viaduct. So the competition was for the control center. Is in Paris, in La Défense, and after La Défense. And this is for the control center under the bridge. But the bridge is crossing a park, and it was a future public park. So for me, it was impossible to make Benin in the center of a public park, to split the park in two parts. So I decided to, by lifting the Benin, having the Benin inserted into the support of the bridge, we lift it and we say there is a passage, there is a view passing under this. And in the middle of the competition, or at the beginning of the competition, we were not supposed to design the bridge. So we asked if we can propose the bridge. And they said, yes, you can propose the bridge. And by this bridge, I redesigned the bridge, having this steel support, basically, having the span underneath, which is curved, long, so 35 meters in between, and the building is suspended in place. And by doing that, we were not supposed to build the bridge ourselves, just to propose the design. But because the building was depending on the bridge, they had to give us a commission for the bridge. It was the intention. Like that. So the building is really above. And everything is in that level. We have a big bin in the middle, a big structure. Rooms on this other side, this is the meeting rooms and extra meeting cantilever, and in the middle just a little step and little block for the machines. And we split the waterways because this is waterways above. Three ways on one side, four ways on one side, the other side. So it's a big bridge. But by making it curled underneath, we cut the impression of the thickness of it. And providing light in the middle. We are in Rome. This is Rome. And this is the old Rome. And this is a place where I won the competition for the Museum of Contemporary Art in Rome in 2001. And so this is, okay. This is the context where I was. The old building, it was part of the brewery Peroni. And it was a place where they had, this is the backside. And this is all these old buildings that we had on the side. And they organized a competition to transform, they were already transforming this building for a gallery of modern art with two wings on both sides and a courtyard in the middle. And they asked for the competition to build the second part, which is bigger than the first part, to develop that at the end of the museum. So, how do we work? We started by doing models. This is a site. This is the previous building, we don't move that, and we have the site. So, thinking about the program, discussing about the program. The brief was very little, because only three pages of text, so nothing. And we have to invent ourselves to think about the program of this competition. And so that means that doing a little model, and starting to manipulate form as much as long as on the way to understand the program. Like that. There are nothing to do with the project as yet. But this is just making the brain work by doing sketch models that try to help us to think and to develop the proposal. And at the end, we came to that. Filling the space, covering by a big roof on the side, 3,000 meters, square meters, keeping that volume, that structure and those that we have to keep. The facade that they asked us to put, okay? And cutting the corner there and leaving these two streets to make a new entrance. Because the former entrance was there. So I have to explain you something. The entrance at this former entrance and this one are 4 meters and a half of different level. This one is higher than this one. So by opening this door, because the streets are going down from both sides. So that we are in Rome. We are in a city where the history is very important, where the Roman time is very important. Everywhere you have ruins and you live with the ruins. But at the same time, everything is protected. So creating a new building in Rome was a bit of a challenge. And I don't like that we have been asked to keep the facade and to build something behind, because this is a kind of a false way of thinking. But in that case, I took the opportunity of doing that by keeping the facade, creating a new entrance, and deciding to build a new world inside. and this is for metals and half below than the fundamentals. So I was thinking that having a ramp on this courtyard, this ramp is going up above the roof, and this one is going down, and we can have another ramp going up into there. So connecting the former place part and the second and the new part by ramps. By creating this roof, and they asked to have a little garden. From the beginning, in the brief, it was written that. So we decided to cut a little hole here, after the entrance, to cross a little garden with some trees. So, and it became like that. This is the former building, the glass roof was there. The total surface that we built is a little tree there. A glass box in the center, which will be, which was for me, but from them, because we are in Rome. And in this area, which is outside the old Rome, yeah, and that area was built in the end of the 90s and beginning of the 20s. And this area has no square. You know, when you, for those who are being in Rome, what is important is to go to the squares. Because the squares are all the place where the life is, you have cafe, you have restaurant, everywhere. And you travel, when you travel in Rome, you travel from square to square. You don't go on boulevards and avenues, they don't exist. Only little streets and you travel as you want, but from square to square. And this is your way of understanding the city. But in that area, they didn't have a square. So I decided by doing that, that the roof will become a public space, a public square. Because with this ramp, we could have entered this entrance, going up to the roof. By creating a little step, a stair under this part of the roof, going down to the street, you can cross the building, over, pass over the building, on the roof, on the square, on the public square. And in the former structure that I had to keep, I established the restaurant. The restaurant in front of the fountain is the terrace for the cafe. And underneath, there is a new, another surface, which is a foyer and all the space below. And the main exhibition room is at the corner there. And this is 1,000 square meters. At the level of the entrance of there, of this building, you have the second exhibition room, which is 500 square meters. And in the center, we have the foyer, with an auditorium in the center, and passerelle at mid-level to travel into the building. So the museum is established between these two surfaces, the foyer and the roof. The public space outside, the public space and inside. And these two surfaces are covered with the same stones as the one with the pavement in the city, the basalt. That is the continuity of the city into the building and over the building, on the public spaces. So now we can, and this is, so it's a steel structure, it was a long, I will not explain all the story. It was a very long discussion to negotiation with the firemen to obtain the possibility to build with the steel, because it was an enormous quality. But finally, I succeeded here. And this is the new entrance. Cutting the facade on both sides, having beams on both sides behind the facade, suspending a glass box, which is the cafe. The cafe is over the entrance, and the entrance is underneath. Crossing the little garden, as I said, the little garden with some trees, and entering a new space inside. Some stairs. Passerelles, and everything inside is painted, oh my god, it's painted in black. No, it's very sensible though. It's painted in black, except the auditorium. And the passerelles are suspended to the roof. The roof itself is a big surface, as I said, of 3,000 square meters, with only four pillars supported, and also the wall between the foyer and the exhibition room. Because I had to have pillars everywhere in the room. I want to have free space all the time. So this is black basalt, black walls, black structure, and black ceiling. And the natural light is coming from the entrance box and from the fountain, which is above. And the fountain is over the auditorium, the auditorium above, and the public space. You cross, what is that? Okay, you cross and you travel. So there are three layers of traveling into the building. The foyer, the first time, okay. So you can travel and decide where you want to go.
It's very sentimental.
I can't change it.
So the auditorium itself is an irregular shaped volume, lifted from the floor, because we did a slope underneath to lighten, to make it floating, flying a little bit above the ground. And this is red, a matte red. And going and inside this red, everything is red. The walls, the ceiling, the floor, and the seats. At the beginning of the construction site, the city of Rome, which was my client, told me, well, do you want to decide for the furniture and to design the furniture if you want? I said, okay, you want to do that? Okay, I said, yes. So they asked me to do that without being paid more. So I decided because I said, I can start to do the global design that I like. That means doing the building and the furniture and finishing everything by myself. So the seats, if I can fix it. Okay. The seat is like a bench. This is a long bench with my arm support that you can be all together if you left them and also separated if you sit in the front. On the back side of the seat, there is a little tablet. And this tablet could be going up. And at this time, the light is switching on. And if you store the tablet, the light is switching off. And this auditorium is a place where they look at movies because they have a big collection of movies from the 60s, from art movies, and video art. And they have a big collection, one of the best collections in the world. And they watch that and they do lecture, they do conferences. They were, because now they're in the new city, Mayor, which has been a bit in trouble. So this is the main exhibition room. And what is an exhibition room in art in contemporary art? Everybody was saying after Richard Mayer that it has been a white neutral box. And when I started to work on this museum, I was reading an article, a discussion between Daniel Buren and Frank Gehry. And Frank Gehry was asking to Daniel Buren, do you think that a contemporary art museum has to be a white neutral box? And Daniel Buren answered, not obligatory. You can do something. You can act as an architect, but please give to the place for exhibition a calm. The other place, you can do what you want. So I have done my exhibition room white, so they can transform it, they can paint it, they can do what they want. The floor is simple and concrete, except the ceiling, which is black because it's very hard. It goes from 11 meters to 7 meters high. Because of the program, which was absolutely bizarre at the beginning, but now it's nice. And this is where we have all the shafts of the systems and all the electricity. So we don't see that, and they are just concentrated on the part which is below. And there is one of the passerelles which is crossing the wall and running along the wall to go to the roof, to the space above. So that means that you can travel the space on the mid-level, and you can have exhibition seen only from the bottom, from the passerelle. You have something on the floor, for example. This is opportunities for creators. The roof is a territory. It's a place for exhibition, it's a place for meeting, it's a place for having parties, etc. We painted the walls of the neighbors in white, and they can project, and sometimes they project images or art on the walls. In between the different levels of this roof, we created glass spaces. And this glass is not totally transparent. This is always laminated glass, and inside there is a mesh of stainless steel with four different density. I did that with the daughter of Jean Prouvé, that I met once, and I said, and she was sewing this textile of mesh of stainless steel, and I proposed her that we can start to develop this laminated glass with the mesh inside. And we did that. And depending on the orientation of the glass, we choose four different density of this mesh. And to the, on this part, which is facing above the exhibition room, I did not want that people look too much to the exhibition below. So this is a more dense mesh. But you can, if you go very close, you can look through a little bit, but at the same time, it's protecting from the sun the exhibition below. And the light is provided by some lamps that are installed under this glass roof, glass part of the roof, to light the surface of the glass. I try to do that delicately. In front of the restaurant, I have done these lamps, which are zablots. And zablots were done before for the video, the Banco Popular that I showed you before. And it was real zablots that we decided to build in the office and to transform in lamps. And we proposed that to the bank. And we had a meeting, main meeting room in the building with 10 of these zablots. And when I started the macro, and the city was asking me to develop if I wanted everything, I said, I will do lamps now. So I was really studied by zablots. And I went to the Salon de Mobile because every 3 years there is a light, the lighting companies. And I visited 4 or 10, I don't remember, a certain quantity of companies, and I chose one, and we decided to build and to develop the lamps with the jablots. So there are single jablots and single jablots. And in the cafe, we designed the tables and the seats with a lot of colors. So what is important in that building that we have, I told you, we have 3 levels. The foyer, the mid-level of the pastel and the cafe, and the top level, which is the common. So that means that for the building around, we were not used to have public building in front of them. They have relation at different levels. The ground floor has relation to the ground floor of the museum. The apartments, which are the first floor or second floor, are in relation with the cafe. And the third and fourth floor are well in relation to the square wall. So every level, every floor of the building around have different relations to the museum. We develop the handles, the button, the and toilets. As I always say, I love defining toilets. Why? Because when you are an architect, you discover that the only place, the only space where nobody gives you regulation, these are the toilets. So toilets is the place where you can experiment, when you can play. So because you need to have a dimension, because I already have certain dimension, you need to have air, ventilation, and light. That's it. But nobody asks you and nobody discusses with you with toilets. So you can do what you want. So my toilets in the background has been designed in relation, in reference to the movie by Dr. Pete Playtime. We all have seen this movie, Playtime, by Jack Betty. Nobody.
Yes, sir.
Wait. Ah, okay, sorry. So you have to all watch this movie. It has been done in 65. And it was the last movie that he did, Jack Betty. He was ruined after this movie, which was absolutely no success. But now it's a big reference. So in that movie, he was trying to describe the future of the world and cities which was coming. And that means that every image, every shooting, every space is bright, cool, smooth, no asperity, no rugosity. All the people and the people who are traveling and moving into that movie are talking all the language of the world. Starting a sentence in French, continuing in English, finishing in Japanese, the other one you're talking in Syrian, Turkish. And okay, this is not, the story has no importance. But this is the traveling through the city which is important. And at one of the first sequences, Jacques Tati, who is playing the main character, is coming into an office building. And in that office building, he's walking on a floor which is covered by steel. And there is the song in that movie is very important. So because he wears leather soles under his shoes, when you walk on with leather soles under your shoes on your steel floor, this is click, mm-hmm. soundy. So I said, okay, I can use that soundy system for my toilets. So my toilets is the kind of a pine pit inserted under the old structure that I had to keep, covered by mirrors and steel outside and inside. Having in the central space big mirrors on both extremities to repeat infinitely the space, as in the movie by Jacques Tati. When you go out of the toilet, you want to go to wash your hands. But the only thing that you find is that object, which is white, lighting, and glass, with landscape in depression alone. And you can start to make your hands dancing. So as soon as you make your hands dancing above, at one point you cross an infrared ray. And this infrared ray makes the water, oh my God, the water coming like that, or like that. At another point, there is a dryer, which is coming. So you play, you manipulate your hands, you don't touch anything, but you are dancing your hands above the, top, the block, and you can play with other people, and you smile when you go out. And at the end, when it's red, oh my God, when it's red, the red is in fear. And I always say usually that because the cold, smooth, and without asperity of the world that Jacques Tati was dreaming is not coming. It's more warm now. Because this is fire and water, this happens. And this building is a very little one, 1,000 square meters in Japan. And I did that in 2006. I was supposed to go to our tool in Shanghai for a tower in the center of China. And the developer was in Shanghai, and he told me that, I received an email, because the email was starting at this time, 2006. I received an email that he was telling me, do you want to come for the jury, but you can propose a project. He said, the project is for one. He said, do a pavilion. I said, but what is the site? And he sent me the equivalent of a sheet of paper, A0, with nothing on it. Just a little circle, and he said, this is the pond, this is the wire, you have to put your pavilion. Okay, and what will be around? Furniture, fair, whatever. Okay. So this was outside Shanghai. So I had this pond, but this pond was too small to have the building of 1,000. I decided to put the building above, but on and down, on the water. And it's like that. It's a pavilion. We had a model, because it was 15 days before coming. So we had a model for a pavilion that we wanted to build. We were able to build an exhibition in Bratislava once, and it had not been built. So I said, why not using this pavilion and build it at the building of 1,000 square meters? So I proposed a drawing. We did an image. I came to the jury, and he asked me, did you bring a project? And I proposed the booklet, and he said, do you have others? I said, no, this is the only one. He said, okay, we will build it. So it was in May 2006, and 1 year and a half later, it was built. And I came twice, and it was built. But my trick was that building that is not so easy, because the structure inside is not so easy, because it's really folding itself. And they did not know how to do that at this time. Now, they know how to do that. But at this time, they did not know. So I was memorizing a sentence that Peter Weiss told me. So Peter Weiss at one of our meetings told me once that when Renzo Piano won the competition for the airport of Japan, Sendai in the cities.
Osaka.
Right. Yes, he won the competition. And he has been invited to come for a ceremony, and they gave him a check, and he said, thank you, we will build it. And he said, no, you can't build my building without me. So, and he said, can we have a meeting together? And they were around the table, and they discovered that it was quite complex for them, because of the glass, because of the structures there. He said, okay, you let me do the outside, and you do what you want inside. So I did exactly the same with that. So in my little building, it was for an airport to do that. So I said, if you want, I can help you. So we started to discuss by internet, by email. So it was a very, for you it's normal, but 2006, so it means less than 15 years ago, it was not so easy to send files through internet. It was not so easy to send files by emails. Mm. So the discussion was quite complicated. But we did. And at the end, the space inside is like that. So look at the buildings around. So when I discovered at the end what they were building around, I said, my God, what is that? And it's an English company who did that for a fire. So it's that. Okay. And inside, the structure is here. Okay. And look at the, some beams are very good, the connection are so it was complicated. But at this time, you know, the structure, we didn't have an island. We didn't have 3D maps, 3D files, 3D. It was impossible. So it was this, the very...
Archicad.
No, but even not. It was just a... The very simple 3D model, 3D sketchup. It was sketchup. So the files were not, the face were not connected, you know, it was very complicated. So it was the beginning of SketchUp, you know, it was really the beginning of SketchUp 2006, less than 15 years ago. For you, it's the prehistory, it's prehistory, but it's not, it was my life. And, okay, now I show you the FRAC, which is another museum that I did in Rennes, in Brittany, the FRAC Open. So for this project, and I tried to do first because I have 250 to show you. So, this place is out in Rennes, in the city, and in the north part of the city. And the preliminary construction was this sculpture. And this sculpture is a three-dimensional sculpture of an artist, which French artist, a woman who died in 2007, I think. And if I remember, and she was 94, 96, and this her own piece in three dimensions. And she is a concrete artist working on the number in abstraction. So she did that on the number 9. So that means that every stone is 4.5 meters high. Every stone is 91 centimeters by 72. And the angle and the position of the quantity of the 72 stones is specific with relation to the number 9. And she knew that. You know, the concert was stopped once because of that. So stop. Don't use your telephone. I can say that. In every concert you say that. So, and she knew that the museum will come and the project will come. So she said, and she gave regulation or constraint to the architect to build the museum. Usually this is the index, but in that time it was the artist who gave constraint to the architect. And she said that she wanted to have a salon-shoes facade in front of her piece and to not like her piece from the building.
Not me, it's the computer piece.
It's
Wi-Fi.
It's Wi-Fi.
The Wi-Fi. So, and she said to respect that she's an artist. So this height of 4.5 meters is exactly this line. So this is aligned with this height of the space. And salon shoes facade, because it's a black facade, flat. The top part is covering the facade of the main exhibition room, which is all the way long of the building, 50 meters long. And the material is black stainless steel mirror. And because it's black, but you don't see it black because the sky is blue and the gray. And because it's mirror, it changes of colors every day, depending on the weather. Depending on the sky. Sometimes it's blue, dark, gray, whatever, depending on the weather. The bottom part is glass. But what you see as a black glass is not black, it's gray. It started very dark, becoming more transparent, going down. But it's perceived as dark and black because we are in the daylight. And the daylight is outside and providing more light than inside. So this is the block. And the, okay. So on the B side, there is a third block, the block of concrete, black concrete, that you perceive as gray because the weather is dry. And that when it becomes humid with rain, the concrete becomes dark, nearly black. So these are three different materials, black, well, as supposed to be black, but playing with the weather and the day. So changing the perception of the building of the time. The entrance is here. Now it's written. And inside, this is a black monolith in front of a piece, silent juice. And inside, this is something else. It's totally bright because of the light. And because the light is providing by, because I cut the block in diagonal. And from the top to the bottom to the storage, 8 meters below. So this is a void of 30 meters high, very narrow but very long, providing all the light into the space. When you come into the museum, you are facing the back of the auditorium, you see the space in the middle, but you can't go there. To go to there, you have to go back to the facade. And the facade is transparent, and you look at the piece. And you have to start traveling the middle of the facade by these steps. And go. Okay? Go all the way along, in between the auditorium and the facade. Reproject yourself to the outside. Going to the end, where you find the café. And the café is open to the park, because you are in the park. And after the café, you can go inside the space by taking steps around. Sometimes a stair, and the stair is particular, because the steps are anchored into the concrete wall, something like that. The parapet is suspended glass with an umbrella which is thick, because it will turn, this umbrella will turn all the way around the space, vertical space, which is narrow, with a void. And I didn't want that people have trouble facing this vertical, facing this void. So this parapet is thick, but it's going to the belly and it gives security for people. And you go up in that space. The library, in between, is for the kids. Okay, you can find time. And you go up, and the exhibition room. It's really. Okay, toilets. Very good. Toilets, it's written, this is toilets. With light. And inside, this is mirror, undulated mirror partition in between men and women, with where you have the place for washing your hands. So when you come to wash your hands, depending on where you are in the curve, that way or that way, you are not looking the same. You are never looking who you are, because you are in a mirror curved. So you look thicker or slimmer, but never yourself. At the end, the client, which is a region, said this is very violent, and I said, no, this is just art. Okay. It goes too fast. It's not good. Okay. Oh, no. Okay, we go back to the toilet. No. No, it doesn't happen. It's clicking. I have to make that one.
Do you want to pass away?
Peut-être si vous posez sur le support,
ça va être plus précis quand vous en voulez. So in the night, because we are left to toilet, the composition of the facade is inverse. Because we lighted the auditorium, the top part is becoming dark. We see the auditorium from outside until it becomes dark. Black. No, it's a nightmare, this thing. What?
Just go like this, I'll do it. No, just give me a signal, I'll do it.
What?
Just go like this and I'll change.
What?
I'll change, just give me a signal and I'll change it.
Yeah. Like that. So we are in China, we are in Beijing. I did a competition for the New Zealand for the first Homo erectus discovered, the world, the older one. And I went to the site, and the site was enormous. And in this little mountain hill, I don't know, there are caves and rocks. And I went to the cave where they discovered the bones of the Homo erectus. So can you imagine going now to this cave where they have discovered the Homo erectus? That means that where the bones were, the Homo erectus was walking. And you walk on the same ground as in, the man and the woman. So, and the site was so big that they said you can install and propose to do the museum whatever you want. So I decided to bring my museum close to the facade. Because I wanted to show that this museum is coming from the face of the mountain. So starting by lifting, by doing some drawings, lifting the thing with the curved line of the site, and until we did the model with papers. Until that. So this is the museum. And the museum is 20,000 square meters. And it's close to the mountain because we have to go back, and the landscape is going above. So we reinserted the museum into the landscape and to the curve of the mountain, and revealing all the lines of the curve line of the site on the facade. Like that. Okay. Nice. Sometimes no. Nice. It's finally easier. And we designed, no, I didn't. We designed the landscape, we designed everything, but at the end we didn't do it, but it was exactly what we did, because they appointed another architect. And inside, there is a vertical patio. And this atrium is particular, because I wanted again to provide a promenade into the museum. And this promenade is by thousands of people, not by 10,000, but thousands of people, but not at the other museum that I did. So this is way out to the escalator. And I decided to do a hall into the first floor, not regularly, to do the second one a bit like that, and the third one like that, to keep moving from floor to floor. And to have the escalators at different positions in between them, to make people turning around the auditorium. And when they were turning around the auditorium, they could have a look on both sides of the place where there are different exhibitions, and to decide where to go. That means going by discovering or turning around the space by going and decide where they want to go. But now I don't know what the exhibition is. So, okay, thank you. We are in Lyon, back to Lyon, for the one we were living in Lyon last year. But, and, so this is the peninsula of La Confluence, between the Rhône and the Saône, and it was a former harbor of the city, where we still have some cranes and for transporting the goods from the river to the harbor. And the company VNF, with the Navigate de France, who is the property of this gate, decided to do a competition for not only renovating the building for the salt, renovating the custom and the building for the sugar, but building other pavilion. Here at the end, you have the museum by Cookie Ben Blanc, the Musée des Confluences, which is a big object for 2,000 square meters of exhibition inside, and the pavilion were for 8,000 square meters. So I decided to do this one, because you could choose where you want to be. So I decided to do this one, the end of the pier, before the bridge. And so the site is 30 meters by 50 meters. And I decided not only to build, so it was supposed to be, I was supposed to build the parapet. But I did not want to build the parapet. So it, and with the void in the middle, with an atrium, to provide light, because it's a really big parapet. So I decided to make shifting the top part of the building, having the ground floor and the mezzanine space on the side, and shifting the top part above the gate. Okay, so that means this is the site. The site is here, and all this part is in cantilever above the gate. The river is here to bring the offices to the river. And because, and inside, I decided I had to do for doing that. Big pylons, like that, three big pylons, to support the beams, which are in cross, and the perimetral beams, which are very heavy, and to suspend and to hang the different floors from the top, the structure of the top to the bottom. And this is 5 floors suspended to the big structure in cantilever 25 meters. So this is enormous, and 6 meters above the ground. And, okay. So this is my founder's construction. We started by building the car park underneath, one floor, and by building this big part of in concrete, not big, because it's just for toilets and shafts, and all electricity in connection. And the three pylons came once, and after that the beams. And if you look at the beams, one of the beams was, look at the guy. Okay. So this one is 4.5 meters high. Because the floor, the roof is inclined and this is the part to be to support the cantilena. So this is very, very big and solid. And this is it. So from coming from the north, you can pass underneath and go to the bridge and go to the end of the confluence. This part is on the site, this part is out. And the escaping air is on the facade and going back into the building. No, go back. We have been asked, it was a competition, we have been asked to work with artists. We integrate an artist with us in the team. So I decided to work with Philippe Chevalier, who is a Swiss artist living in Paris. And this artist is working, always working with perspectives and point of view. And I told him that my building was very simple. I said, okay, Philippe, my building is simple. This is a parallelepiped, shifting parallelepiped in glass, so simple box. Can you transform the perception of my building? And he answered to me immediately, don't give an order to an artist. I do what I want. Okay? We do what you want. So he came back to me 3 weeks later and he said, okay, I'll do it. Architecture is arrogant because architecture is erasing the landscape that was previously there. So I want to reestablish the landscape on your building to make your building the journey. Okay, it's fine. So taking photos from the top of the building in 4 directions and reapplying the photo on the facade. If you look carefully on this photo, on this facade, you see the bridge now. You see the bridge. So every facade has the photo of the which is behind the building. And I told him, thank you. Because by applying this photo into my glass, I could filter the light, so finally art is convenient for architecture. but we could take in consideration the gradation of the gray of the photo, the grayish part of the photo, to filter and calculate the heating in going into the building. And it gives a lot of, because there are 3 layers of glass at the back, and this is really providing, blurring the perception, blurring the what it is exactly. And this is a container. Look at the people down. So this is huge. And if you look carefully, there is a glass ceiling underneath, because when we are shifting the building, we are shifting the atrium at the same time, so passing on the quay. I mean, passing under the atrium, and you can look through the building. And inside, the first floor and the ground and the mezzanine is for exhibition, public spaces, etc. So it's quite empty. And inside, we have the three pylons. In one of the pylons, we have a staircase. In another one, we have 2 lifts, and the other one has a lift. So this is the place for traveling into the space. And all the plateau around and the floor around are open spaces without any partition and only some boxes, glass box when you need it to have a closed office. When you do an office building, you have to usually you do false floor and false ceiling. But in that building I didn't want to do false ceiling. I have to keep the false floor because this is for the irrigation and the connection between people. But if you do false ceiling, and we have a glass box, so you can't use the inertia of the slab to transfer the heating during the day into the concrete slab. So I decided to take off the false ceiling. By doing that, I had first to care a lot about the position of the shaft and everything which is interesting. Also, I had to provide, because it's offices, acoustic system and lighting. So I decided to do something, an arm, an object, with playing with acoustic and light and lighting. So this is the scheme that I sent to the company with who I did the jacket at the beginning, and to ask for them to them a prototype. So because this lamp that I call Petal could be as a acoustic panel, absorb the sound from above and from below, and underneath there is a light. So they can fly above the desk, above the place where you work, and this is comfortable to provide the light and the acoustic. And so the question of acoustics is how to do that. Flying above the desk, open desk, open everything. And the toilets, red, open to the city, with the basin, which is in common between men and women, so you can check your hands. In Paris, Le Carnot, this is a place where you discover if you go there in the 18th arrondissement, if I remember, no, 18 or 17th?
19.
This is the old building, the old warehouse built in the 60s. And this is 400, 600 meters long. It's very, very long. And it's not just warehouse of two floors. And the city bought it at the end of the 90s and decided to do a competition. And Dracula's won the competition to transform that part. And to transform it as a city on itself. By, because they discovered when they studied the building that the structure was strong enough to be 6 floors above. And they decided to create a car park of 2 floors below this warehouse and to build 6 floors above. Housing, offices, incubator of startup, and to do a competition at the end for shops, schools, and sport facilities for the area. So this is the city in itself. Taking it in the, some part, there's a tramway passing by, there's a station on the other side. So, and they decided who will build it to different pieces. And they gave me that, the incubator for startup. So, Francoulas gave only one regulation for the architecture. He said, I don't know, mineral, crystal, mineral. That's it. And for the crystal, you have to go back. So I decided to keep the facade of the old warehouse, the green, from the 60s, to go back, as he said, and to do something mineral and otherwise. So, my building is not an official building, not a normal official building. It's an incubator for multimedia startups. So I said, okay, I can play with this facade, and I decided to do the works. Ideas, the works, okay. On the south facade, white. On the north facade, black. And I'm the only one who has the east facade, because I have the facade before the sport facilities. And on the east facade, black and white. So as soon as we did that, I said, okay, now the building will be everywhere black and white, only black and white, except for the meeting rooms and the bubbles for the meeting rooms. So the entrance lobby is black and white with a meeting room suspended over. Right. On the back side, we have another lobby, another hall, black and white with a meeting room suspended over. The staircase is going there. And to enter into the bubble, you enter with the bathroom. Inside, this is a grot, in a way. We decided to design a shape for having a table, the irregular shape. And we discussed with a carpet company to do bubbles also, part of the bubbles, to have black and white also on the floor. And when the lift, at every floor, the lift are coming in a space which is black and white. And sometimes, and at some, and many, most of the floor, we have convivial space where we decided to design this little seat and this flying fetal, and it's black and white. And you go up, the top part is with bubbles outside, so this is providing big, big windows out from outside. And there is a terrace on the top floor. And we just deliver now this office building that I call the twist, because this is a building of 10,000. Here's the first one, the cargo was 17,000 square, this one is 10, only 10. But this is a building with 3 blocks, with in between the 3 blocks, 2 green, kind of greenhouse with staircases and lift. And every facade has to be treated depending on the sun and the light. Because we are in between 2 bridges. On the left side, we have the bridge of the train coming from Saint-Lazare. That means a very long bridge of 200 meters below. And on the other side, we have a little bridge, which is from the new street that is going to Plattenberg. and to the new tribunal, the new courthouse. And as a facade is going down to the boulevard in Paris. So we are on the railways, and you see one facade, the west facade of the building. And the east facade of the building has shutters, flexible and folding shutters. So the shutters here, if you come from the Salazar, the face of the shutter that you see are black. When you come from the outside, the face of the shutter that you see are white. So you play, and this is not the same building that you see on the side. So these are three blocks. The top part could be higher, because it was depending on the boulevard down, and it could go to 8 floors plus a terrace of terrace. This one has to stay on 6 floors, and this little block on the east side has to stay on 4 floors. So this is the regulation that we have on this place. Okay. And this facade is going down between the bridge of the train and the bridge for the car. And we are just in between. And under that building, we have 3 floors, we have 350 car parks. A car park of 350 seats. And this is a huge building because we have to maintain the rails and the train. And on the other side, there is a tunnel. And this tunnel is going to the courtyard, to the courthouse for the prisoners. So this is very delicate and very sensible. So this one was built before us, but this tunnel was just built before we started the construction. And we discovered that this tunnel was not stable because they built it without taking care of who was coming on the east side. So we had to re-maintain the tunnel when we were building the building. So it was a huge complication of the construction program. And we folded the facade of this vertical part because, as you see before, the side before, I discovered when I was traveling on this boulevard before the competition, that when we were traveling there, the building, we had the impression that the building will come over the bridge on both sides. So I was thinking that this could be a signal that we're vertical and we have to be different. To twist it, to provide different faces to the different directions. And this top part, and the construction is very particular. So this is the steel structure first. The columns are in steel. And this is a building of 20 meters large. We have 20 meters from here. This is a slab which is built of a mixed construction of wood and concrete. So the beams are in wood. And they are vertical sheets of wood glued together steel beams between the columns. And the columns are very small, very little. And the concrete is going over in cantilever on 2 meters and a half on both sides, because the distance between the columns is 13 meters wide. And because we have the shifting part, we have a big cantilever here above for the 7 and the 8 floors above. So this is a shifted volume with cantilever and with very thin supported structure and big beams in wood. Inside, that is the impression of that. Because in Paris now, every building has to have wood somewhere. So we decided to do with the ceiling to provide a calm atmosphere, a nice atmosphere into the offices. So all these beams are separated by void, and in that void we have the shaft to get the plateau. We have to re-exhibit everything again. This is the shaft and that is in the black. This is the big shaft on the side. And everything is at the same height. We have just the light which are flying over us. And the staircase, which I say that it's a greenhouse because we have plants on the bottom part. The staircase is mixed between glass, steel, and wood. And the facade on the east, on the west part is with serigraphy, dots of serigraphy, and on the top part, this is solar cells. And this transforms the lighting and the play with the light and play with shadows and it provides a lot of shadows and transformation of the perception of the space during all the day. At the extremity on the last, at the other part, at the other extremity, there is a cantilever again, and underneath we have the bicycle space, which is a bubble with sheets of metal, and the bicycle inside, and the back side. Mm-hmm. If you look at from the periphery, you can, from the periphery, you see this end of the, this, end, this red one. And there is the light inside. Mm-hmm. In Barcelona, I won the competition in 2015, which is a tower. Here, there was before a tower which was a concrete structure, a skeleton, which was remaining there for 10 years, 12 years. And the company from outside Spain bought it and decided to develop it as a tower for high-class residency. That means we had 15 floors, we had a building on the backside, and we destroyed the backside, the building of the backside, to add the surface of the backside above the existing structure, to reach 100 meters high with more floors. And because it was residency, and the distance between the slabs were not so high, so we don't have big height into the glass, the client wanted to expand the walls, the floors, the slabs, by creating big balconies. And we had the possibility to increase the balcony 3 meters, 2 meters, 2 meters. So the first part of the work started by reinforcing the structure by sending some foundation through the foundation of the park, so the parking, which is belonging to the hotel on the east side, through the former partition to the ground, and the ground is close to the sea, so we have a lot of water inside and sand, and to reinforce the slab above, and reinforce the slab, every stitch slab at every level to create the balconies. Yeah. On this photo, we miss one floor, just one floor, and all the balconies, the new balconies are there, and this tower, at the end, will be like that. White and at the end of it in the place. And the lobby, we destroyed the two first floors of the tower to create a high balcony and high lobby. And the lobby will keep the columns outside. Behind, we have an undulated glass facade of 9 meters high, with sheets of glass of 9 meters, standing themselves like that, anchored into the floor and standing, maintaining on the top, to create a huge lobby like that. If you look at the chandelier, and we decided to create a chandelier with a chandelier with 25 chandeliers, because we have 9 meters high for doing this lobby. This is the model that we did for the Venice. This is the model that we did at the scale 130. Joseph printed everything on your object for the Venice. Okay? And you reconnect it up. Yeah. And this is, it will be the restaurant and with a mirror ceiling to increase the height, even if it's already 9 meters high. And we design everything. Again, this is global design. We design everything. We design the lamp, we design the sink, we design the bathroom, we design the kitchen island, we design the staircase, the steps, etc. On the back side, this is that. And with a little pavilion on the bottom part of the garden mirror. Yeah. And the rooftop and the swimming pool. Mm-hmm. But the swimming pool, we needed to have water on the rooftop because of the sprinklers. Mm-hmm. So we decided to not create a tank, but a swimming pool. Mm-hmm. No, it's in there. So we decided to do a swimming pool. And at the end, the firemen agreed that we can transform this swimming pool for the tank, as a tank for the sprinklers. We didn't delay. Okay. And sometimes I do a little project. This is an artist residence in Grenoble. An art collector, who is a woman, lives in that manor. Above the center of the which is very low, with a cloth, and underneath there is a glove of Bernard, and this is a stone, and the Alps Chêne. And she decided to create an artist residence on her site. So I came there, and I discovered that the site that she wanted to provide for this artist residence was full of trees, full of greenness, right? It was very nice. And, but when I was in her manor, I was looking at the view with the valley and the Alps, and it's a beautiful view. And I said, why keeping the artist under the trees and having the view only for her? I wanted to provide the view for the artist. So I decided to create a kind of a belvedere going above the trees by having a box, a glove, a box, and I built all in. Usually I don't build in wood, but this one is all in wood. The structure, the facade, everything inside is wood. So this is the box, a black box, silencious, overlooking the Alps and not disturbing our life. When you go down, you discover that it has been twisted a little bit to have different orientation for the windows to catch the sun into the space and underneath. You have the workshop underneath, the living room, the bedroom, and the bedroom. So this is very little. At the end, it's only 170 square meters. 100 square meters for the workshop and different square meters for the other one. So it does, it looks like that. Inside wood and concrete, because on this side we are maintaining the garden which is above. Very narrow space for planning until the level there, which is like that. Overlooking the airport here at the end. So this is a black building, black house in wood. In Brittany, I built a glass house white. So this is for an Englishman, an industrial, who came to me and said that he wanted to do a glass house because he had a problem in his eyes and his view is dampening. So he wanted to build a more lighted, a more bright place as he can. So by building it by himself. So we decided to build in glass. And this is a tiled bed, inclined tiled bed, in white, with a certain quantity of sheets of glass, twice that of glass, with a void in the middle, and inside the void we have a structure, so you don't see anything else as glass. There is an entrance patio, and two glass volumes, black, for the kitchens and the bathrooms. Inside everything is in glass, and there is an inside, nothing is vertical. So it's because everything is inclined. So at the beginning, you have to understand how you feel in that, because it's a bit disturbing, but at the end, it's working. And some transparency for some windows on the bottom part. So interior design now. It's not finished. Don't ask me to show everything, so I try to show a lot. But so, why not traveling on board, on sailing boat? So, once I got a call from a man who was describing me as a lawyer of a client who wanted to build a boat. And this client was reading 1 week before an article, an interview by myself in 2003. It was a woman the weekly women magazine of the Premier Minister. And the journalist was asking me to describe the difference between Paris and Rome. And I said, oh, it's easy, this is a question of plan. So if you go to Paris, if I go to Paris, I take a map and I follow the boulevard, the avenues, I know where is the River Seine, and I know where I am, depending on this element. If I go to Rome and I look at the map, impossible to understand. I throw it away. And I just try to understand where are the squares. And I start to travel in the city from square to square. And my experience is exactly as sailing. Because when you sail, depending on the sun or the wind, your way is not the same. So depending on your humor, of your time in the day and night, in Rome, you decide to do by this street or this street to reach this square or this square. So this is the kind of traveling, navigating into the city. So he read that and he said, oh, this woman, this architect, she knows something about sailing. So he called me, it's exactly the story. So I said, yes, I know about sailing because I'm from Italy, and I was sailing on an avion. So he said, okay, do you want to meet my client? I said, yes, okay. So I came to Rome, and I had a lunch with the lawyer and the client, and it was 3 hours. And we started by discussing about food, whiskey, chocolate, colors, material. It was a very long discussion, knowing each other like that. And at one point, he said, okay, if we, you know, for what we are there. And I said, yes, because you told me. And he said, okay, I want to build the boat. Which color do you think? I said, black, because I'm from Saint Malo. This is the corsair boat. So he said, black is fine. I want to build the black boat. So, and he took from his bag little booklets. And I was looking at this map, at this plan of this huge sailing yacht. And I said, oh my God, I'm dreaming. Because this yacht is 40 meters long. The mast is 50 meters high. And the big sail is 900 square meters. So this is big. So, and we started to discuss about the drawings. And I said, okay, I don't like the windows on the boat. I don't like what how it's done. I said, can I redesign them? You do what you want. I said, if I redo the deck, I want to have a flush deck, a total flush deck, which is a more beautiful deck, boat that I know from the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th year, racing for the investor. And he said, okay, we can do it. So I said, okay, before I bring to this expedition, because I never did the boat, I want to go to the shipyard. So I went to the shipyard and I met the people and I discussed with them and I discovered that they were much more working with partition structure with partition than with annals, because this is a two different way of building a boat. I was not doing the plan and the design of the boat itself, because there is a specialist, an architect specialist in that for me. But I can intervene in it. I started to go, and I went back to London because my client was living in London at this time. And after one day, I said, how do you want to live in? And I said, I want to tell you, how do you want to live in this boat? And we had a long discussion. And at the end of the day, I said, okay, I will do the boat with you. So we started to go every month to the shipyard for 3 months. And when I was designing, the shipyard was starting to build. And they started to build the cock, the hull, and they started to build everything. And they built a warehouse to bring the boat inside, because they didn't have a long warehouse or doing that. And they were doing the mock-up of the interior as soon as they were designing, and after that I redesigned and they came back and they rebuilt the mock-up. And we were doing back and forth like that during 3 years. And it was a fantastic adventure. It was in Italy, on the east coast of Italy, and on the Adriatic Sea, the shipyard was there, and it was fantastic. I learned from them and they learned from me. Because I was looking at all the detail. When you work on a boat, and especially inside the boat, you have to work only in section, mostly on section. Because if you think carefully, the body of the boat is changing every centimeter, every millimeter. So you have to care a lot about the section. And everything has to be designed by section. So this is the first deck of the boat. And they needed to have the winches and the mast anchor into a very big object that they wanted to bring above so they can. I said, no, I have to develop for you the surface of the deck that we can incorporate that into the surface without bringing an object on the top. So we designed for them all the wooden pieces of that, developing that doing a model, and designing them and bringing them to the shipyard, and they understood how to build it and how to develop the surface. So you can pass there, there is no obstacles, there is it's fantastic. For having windows, for providing a natural light underneath, I decided not to build this huge window with front that we have usually in boat, because these are obstacles. And I proposed to have black glass inserted into the deck at the same surface, but just providing the light on both sides of the mount inside. And in the evening, the artificial light is inside of the same place, and the artificial light above is coming from the same place. So all the red is the surface where you can walk. So this is 170 square meters. It's a big flat. Yeah. But and everywhere you stand up. So you never really touch the ceiling. This is the living room. This is one cabin. This is one cabin. When I say that, this is because you don't see the partition of the cabin. Because the part of the partition could slide into that, and this one into that, this one into that, etc. Because you can have the space, you can modulate the space as you want. This is a big loft that you can transform to have the total space or to have different cabins. This bathroom, etc. And the kitchen, the corridor, the master bedroom, and the crew. Master bedroom and bathroom. So in the center part, you have a space where you have some steps, and because everything is in carbon fiber. The steps are anchored into the little slope, which is with the hand inside. You have a bar, and the bar is cut in the middle, because when you want to close the kitchen from the center part, you can make sliding the glass partition. The master bedroom, in that book we designed the bed. And you see that the partition on the back side of the bed is thick, because you can open it and take the partition out, close, and to separate the bedroom from the bathroom. The back of the bathroom is a mirror to increase the perception of the space again. And this is the bathroom. The bathroom has a perforated floor, because this is when you want to have to take your shower. The shower is in the ceiling, and the total space of the bathroom becomes the shower. When you want to take a bath, you push a button, the floor falls, store into the bath partition, and the bath is the floor. So the total bathroom becomes the bathroom, becomes the bath. And we design the bed, the wash basin. And it was very fun. And something else, totally. This house is in the south of France, and it has been built between 65 to 75. By an architect, Odile Decq, who was from Romania, and who was with a man who is an industrial from close to Lyon, and who went to holidays in this part of the coast close to Cannes, in Thiel-sur-Mer, and he fell in love with a little description that Odile Decq did in a huge resort done by Jacques Quel. You have to look at all these names. Jacques Quel built this resort in the 60s, and it's a very organic way of building it. It's absolutely amazing. And Odile Decq was an assistant of Jacques Quel and started to build some objects, a little part. And the client was going to Panama, and Odile Decq became friends and decided to build a house. And he said to Odile Decq, you can do what you want. And Odile Decq decided to do bubbles. So they started to build together by creating a company with a steam worker. And they started by filling them by hand. So this is 600 square meters of bubble built by hands during 10 years. So they started by doing this far part and continuing by adding this man had two kids, and he was, and Thomas was questioning the kids, who do you want to be on the side? Okay. I want to be there, I want to be there. I want to look at the sea, I want to do that. And every room that the kids had was a living room, a kitchen, two bedrooms, and a bathroom. This is like apartments. So this is why at the end it was 620 meters. So the construction of these bubbles are a steel structure that with bars that they were folding. And a mesh of steel, projecting on one side concrete, polishing by hand, this is the outside. Inside, they were projecting foam for insulation, and after that plaster, polishing by hand. Can you imagine the work? And they were changing their mind over time, modifying it, adding something else, without any plan. Once the city said, okay, you are building something, but you don't have a building permit. So, and they asked to that they deposit a building permit. So, until the design a sheet of ASAO like that, this is the building of the project. They're not what is built, but something else. They send that and refuse that they are built. So, and because it's a protected place with historical architects, so the architects from historical monument said, you have to build with tiles, with this curved tile.
Des tuiles
romaines
ou?
Oui, romaines. Comment on appelle ça?
Des tiles?
Tiles, it's tiles. And stucco and something which is traditional. And they said, it's difficult. So on the back side of this
shingles.
Part, there is shingles. A part where there is a vertical wall, empty vertical, with some tiles on the top.
Shingles.
No, this is not shingles.
On s'est trompé.
Terracotta tiles. Terracotta tiles, exactly. Yes. So we have some terracotta tiles above a wall, which is empty. But okay, this is the part. So when they inherited from their father, two persons, a man and a woman, decided to renovate their house. And they wrote emails to 50 architects, and I got one. And I was dreaming when I received them, because these houses, I was dreaming to visit that forever. Because when I was a teenager, somebody from my, connected to my family was doing that. So I decided immediately to call them and came to visit them. And I spent a certain amount of time, and I said, this is not protected, this is the plan, we have to protect that. And they, because they wanted to protect everything inside. But you have to know that this interior of these houses, there are three like that in the south of France, the only one, is the outside, but all the furniture is attached to the wood, and this is very specific and designed absolutely in the correspondence. But they decided they wanted to renovate that and to dismantle that. They said, never, no. So I started by doing, okay, we have to come together in the house for a weekend, and we will pass room by room to discuss what do you want to discuss, what do you want to not discuss. So I was not taking notes, I'm taking photos. After 1 weekend, we didn't finish because it's too big. So we said, okay, in 2 weekends, we come back and we continue. So at the beginning, they wanted to take off that. At the end of the 2 weekends, they decided, okay, we keep everything. Because we are discussing, looking at that, and all the details, etc. And they decided to keep it. And they said, okay, now we can start the renovation of that. So first, I have to have a building permit for the renovation of the outside. With the architects of my story. And he was coming, and we decided to renovate all the windows, and we find somebody to do that, etc. So at the end, we got a permit, and we started to renovate. And inside, for 5 years, we did part of the house to renovate. This house is fantastic. We can't build that today. We can't even depose a permit for that. This is a crime. Why not? We can't build that like that today. So we started by doing the living room. So they said, okay, we can start calm in white. But I found this cushion which were there, because this is a kind of a sofa. And that they were covered by a sponge tissue, exactly. And I said, okay, I can play with colors, and I can play with other colors from the 60s, because this is pop, it was pop art at this time. I said, okay, we can find deserts. No? So we decided, and then before that, so we started by playing with colors. And at the end of the first part of the renovation, because I have used many colors, I said, now we can continue the year after and the year after with the motto of too much is never enough. The title of a book by Ted Lapidus, an architect. You said too much is never enough. Never forget that, too much is never enough. So you can do as maximum as you can. So I said, okay, next time we will continue. So at the end, we did, so this is a bathroom that they didn't change. This is the bathroom of the father. And we started by playing with colors. Pink, orange. So I had to do some bathrooms, because some bathrooms are not there. So I decided not to do bubbles, but to do in the place where it was with the ceiling, to have something which is not a regular bubble, because this, I'm not amplifying, I have a problem, like, so I can use another name. So I design not of the same, like that. I discover that. Can you imagine dreaming of having designed that? I discover two like that. One or pink like that and a bigger one orange in another level. The corridor, which is outside and inside at the same time. Totally organic. And at the end, the last bedroom, because I don't show you everything, but we use 12 colors inside, and I decided at the end, I was thinking, what color the next bedroom? And I said, okay, we play with all the colors together. So we add all the colors together for this. Like that. And 12. Yellow, pink, purple, and green together. Okay. All right. And at the end, because for everybody that I build and I finish, usually I do a kind of an edition with a gallery. And this one, it was plates, porcelain plates, that I did in reference to this house. And the name is Ampoule à Bagolier. Okay, I design. I started by winning competition for the UNESCO headquarters in 2000 for the phone box into the temple. And the phone box, UNESCO headquarters, you have to go there. You have to knock at the door, to push the door and go inside. I didn't, you know, it was a shame for me to go inside the building in 2000 because I was in Paris for many years before. And I didn't want to look at that because it was in concrete and I was not stupid. To say in concrete is not interesting. So when I went there for doing the competition, I discovered that the concrete there is absolutely fantastic. It's incredible. So the UNESCO headquarters has been built by Marcel Breuer, the architect, and Pierre-Luigi Nervi, the engineer. You know who is Pierre-Luigi Nervi? The best engineer of the beginning of the 20th century. So you have to look at his work. And Zerfus as the French architect in correspondence with Marcel Breuer. You know who is Barcelona? No. All the names that I gave you, you have to know them and to look at them. Because this is so important. Because you never work by yourself, you work in reference or in relation or sometimes you think of somebody else. So, this is the place where the concrete is absolutely voluptuous. The concrete is absolutely, it's so complex and voluptuous. In front of the main doors, the two main doors of the main hall, you have flying canopies in concrete. 15 square meters of developed surface, you can think that it could have been done in this parametric knot by hand and drawing by, I don't know how. But it's a sketch and something which has been developed, 15 square meters of flying canopy, put on two little legs, just attached like that, not touching the facade, just table like that. And the main hall is 15 meters high, and there are columns that are starting on. Transforming in oval, finishing hexagonal. The second one is starting square, and every column is different, shaping, transforming the shape all the time. And the main conference room is a huge, huge one with a vault. And this vault is done as if when you come into that room, you believe to be under a pit like a rise, but in concrete. And this is incredible. So I was like, it's a shame that I didn't come into that place before. So I won the competition for the front box because I just wanted to change the super. The front box was a classic bubble orange, and I said, okay, this is for the front building, this is 50s, this is normal. We don't change that. So the director said, for this architect is not expensive, we can ask her to do the furniture. So they asked me to do first the main desk of the main hall for the 500 delegation coming. So I decided, because I had to work in the spirit of the building, which was in the 50s. And the 50s were the erector of plastic. So I decided to build my desk in plastic. So I came to a shipyard close to Paris at 1 hour driving from here. And we did together the mold for building the desk. I did a form, a shape. We did the section because we didn't know how to build this 3D model. Yeah, because at this time, in 2000, the 3D model was not, so it was maquette, model, and section, developing section on the way. And in the mold, I came to correct and to modify the thing. And at the end, it did with plastic. And we had to decide the color. And the color was in discussion with the director of the UNESCO. Because in that room, there are a fresco by Picasso of 50 square meters. There are tapestry by Le Corbusier of 50 square meters. And there are a mosaic by, I don't remember. But because this building, it was the time where we call that the synthesis of art. That means that when an institution were asking or commissioning a big building, they were asking for the greatest architect, for the greatest engineer, and at the end they asked for the greatest artist of the time to provide art for inserting into the building. So this is absolutely amazing. So we chose one of the orange, which is into the fresco by Picasso, to do the desk. And it's a twisted form, in reference to the twisted surface of the concrete into the conference room. And they wanted to have seats, and I could have ordered seats, and I could have designed them. And I decided to design. I was dreaming for designing seats forever, but I didn't dare to do that. So I was starting, I remember at this time there was, in the 60s and in the 50s and even in the 70s, a big sofa that was named the Snake by Pierre Paulin, the French designer who died 2 years ago. Have you heard about him? One of the best designers, French designer for furniture. No. Okay. No, please. Pierre Paulin. So he did a snake, and it was for the men, the big spaces. And I said, look, I was thinking that nobody has really reread this question of the set, but I wanted to design a seat. So I started by designing a normal armchair with a seat and a backside. I decided to do a confidant with two opposite seating and a kind of a meridian with the seat and the back connected together. And if you look carefully, the side of all these seats are exactly the same. So you can put them together and creating sides to the confidant, the snake into the room. So I did individual seats and the snake at the same time. And the laser is in reference of one color in the tapestry that we have. And they're still there. All these seats are there. They wanted to have a table and okay, then the table in plastic again, 3 meters long. Folding down is for having structure underneath and very nice. We wanted to have a paper basket, folding aluminum, polished in a way that would blur the limits of the foams, and a lash. The gallery asked me for a box to storage. I did a box, 1 meter and 50 centimeters long, that you can open like that, sliding apart, lifting the other part, and inside the tray. And then Jumani said, oh, this is nice, this is the bed by for Dracula. I said, okay, it's fine. It's fine. And Lucekan, with who I did the jamot and the petal, asked me for once to do a pendant lamp. And I did what I call the soleil noir, which is a pendant lamp with indirect light underneath. With this disc that above, you have all the light above, and the under surface is the surface that create the light under this and under. So this is a pendant lamp with indirect light. And for the Biennale of Banjo in Korea, they asked to 15 designers to do a lamp, and I was on one of the list, and I proposed to have a kind of a stone with polish the board and lighting on the list, like that. And Alice asked me for doing a tray, and I was thinking, my God, I dream for doing a coffee, something, So a tray, what do I do with this tray? The tray is rectangular, round or square. So I choose it. I said, okay, I play with the rectangular one, and I did two rectangles, shifting one above each other, to fold the side, the difference between the two rectangles, to make the limit of the trend And as you, maybe you believe that it's not totally flat, it's perfectly flat. But the sides are not the same height all around. To perturb the, what you see. This is why I call it Alice. Because Alice in Wonderland, what you see is not what you what you what it is, and what you think it is what you think. And they asked me for a fruit basket. And I did a twist again. And yes. And a friend of mine who is the artist director of a knife company called me once and I said, oh, did you want to design a knife? I said, a knife? Yes, why not? And he said, a folding knife. And I said, oh, not folding knife, I love it. Because folding knife, for me, it's a tool for working. And this tool is totally different depending on the work. And I love that. So even before having not having the right to fly this knife in your pocket, many men are folding knives in that pocket. Because you can do many things with that. So I said, okay, I want to design a knife when you are an architect. So because it's very mythology. So I have to use their blade, because their blade is their signature. So I took the blade, I designed the blade, I did a model of the blade, and after that I took pasta and pasta in my hand, having the blade inside, molding the pasta in my hand and giving to different people in the office the same pasta to look and to check what is comfortable for everybody. And after that I brought the model to my friend, and he said, you did a model for a knife. I said, I don't know how to design a knife. I did a model. So they built it. This is Le Noir, and it's called Le Noir. This is his name. And close to here, in the gallery, the man who is the owner of the gallery, of the art gallery, had a dog. And when I renovated the gallery in 2007, he was living with his dog. But at the same time, he wanted to bring back the top basket that he had built before. And I said, the top basket in a large gallery, for me, this is not possible. So push through that away, and I will design for you the basket for the dog. So I sent somebody to measure the dog. I don't know if it was you, or if it was somebody else, but at this time. And we came to visit the dog, and they came to visit the dog, to measure him if it was sitting, standing up and lying. And we designed a bubble. We molded in aluminum, painted in black, and we asked for a lady in the area to sew the mattress inside for Victor. And Victor has lived here from 2007 until 2017 because he died 2 years ago. Oh. Yes, it's a sad story. But he was happy for this time. And as soon as I did that, I discussed with him and I said, oh, because I can do that for man to mice. And in between, you have the gold. So in 2013, he asked me to do that. This subject exists. And if you have mice in your house, you have to have a farming house for mice. And another guy out there, we started to ask me for doing sculpture. I said, what is a sculpture? So I started to do a mobile. And mobile, middle size, big size, suspending mobile, suspending lights into the air. With surfaces, forms, a little one that I did in red for this gallery. The other one is in red, this one is here. And recently, another gallery asked me to do something for Art Basel. And I did for Art Basel, transforming the mobile into lamps. And I wanted to provide, and he said, can you do another furniture? Like a table for them. I said, why, how to do a table? I said, oh, my. The bubble house and the plates. So I took the ground drawings and I decided to cut sheets of piece of wood, to cut that and to have big tables, high tables, lower table, coffee table. And it's a new way of having tables sitting around the table for socializing different. When you have a normal table, you socialize in front of the others and you have people there, some people. In that one, you can sit in the middle. You can be there only three around, or you can have two persons there. You can play as you want to sit around this table, and you can have a meeting, or a very intimate meeting, or whatever. And this is the form of the pillars and the colors of the pillars. And the lamps. These are real. And in 2 weeks, with the same gallery, on the Place de la Concorde, we will have a back pavilion that you have to visit. A black pavilion of Place de la Concorde. Thank you.
I noticed this idea of huge structure, heavy structure, and disrupted spaces. Is it a reason why you... can you explain why this...
For the Bénélion, for example?
Yeah.
It's because I wanted to refer to the huge trend that we had there before. Industrial. It was an industrial armor, and I wanted to bring back my building into the field of the industrial armor. And so on. And I did, and I said, okay, I can build this huge structure, and I built this building with that. And, but if you look carefully, my building was very simple outside. Normal, very simple structure. But inside, this is something else. And I love to play with that double vision. Outside, simple, inserted into the city calmly. And inside, this is another one for people inside.
I have a kind of personal question.
Personal?
Yeah. As a big architect, when someone called
you... Big architect? No.
No. Someone well-known.
Okay.
When someone called you for a project, do you feel a kind of pressure because of that?
No. I don't feel pressure. I always try to understand what do they want. And if I think that it could be fun, I do it. If I think it can't be fun, I say, okay, no. I am now reaching the time where I can sometimes say no. But you know, I started at the very beginning to say no also, when some commissions were not nice, and I knew that I would be in a trap, in something that I don't want, I said no. And I started by saying no many times at the beginning. And I didn't have work, I didn't have enough money to be, but I said no, because I didn't want to, something that I don't believe in, but I don't trust in. So, I was focused on what I wanted.
And a question. You have a very special relationship with models, meaning they are not zero, representation of the final product. Yes, in the entire presentation we did not. There is only a very few pictures of it. And these models are locked up into your office. I mean, the ones...
They are not locked. They are for the people in the office.
In the office. But they are...
And they are more than 700.
Yeah, I know. Why do you keep these models?
Because they are no question for the brand. When we do something, and I sometimes say, look at this model, look at this model, come to look at this model. And Joseph, I do that sometimes, we do that sometimes, and you look at the model. This is the story of the office, you know?
Yeah,
and some people ask me to sell that, I never want to sell.
No, but it's not about selling, it's about...
Exhibiting?
Yeah, why not? Because they are also speaking.
I'm not showing, I'm not working in a museum.
Or at least showing it in your presentation, because they are also speaking about your work.
My presentation could stand one day if you want. This is only the building that I built.
Yeah.
For doing that, I did so many competitions. We did so many competitions. I have more than 200 or 300 projects, if you want. And some are absolutely incredible, and I dream to build them, but I lost the competition. I won the competition, but they have not been built. So I can do another lecture with only the project won by competition, but not built, if you want. But Excuse me?
This is your model
can
be put into this space.
In this space?
Yeah.
They will not, there are too many.
It's a selection of it.
There are too many. And I did an exhibition in Rome at the beginning of the museum, at the work in 2003, and like, we brought there 90 models. Yes. 90 boxes, because they are all boxes.
At the beginning, you said it was an idea that you were pursuing, that is the idea of dynamic equilibrium. Do you have a request into the ideas you're trying to pursue throughout your projects? And then another question was that there's like a lot of plays with reflection and distortion with the use of materials. You say there is a link between this and the idea of dynamic equilibrium?
Maybe. Yeah, dynamic equilibrium, because when I started, I was always dreaming that my building could move. And I was thinking, how can I make them, the impression that they move, or they are dynamic and they are going on. Yes, it's true, I can show you something from the 80s. Anyway, so there are some stories behind that. And the stories behind that is maybe coming from cinema, because you know, sometimes a long time ago I was saying that, telling that like that. When I was a kid, long time ago, we did not have TV at home. TV came to my home when I was 15. Before we didn't have TV. I went to watch a movie in a cinema when I was 12. So for me, images were fixed and stable. And it was only when I became a teenager that I discovered the animated image. And I'm part of the generation who saw this gap and this jump between a fixed image and animated image. And for me, it was very important to understand how this animated image were done. And this is why, for a long time, I was really looking for the situation that is done into the setting or into how to create an image, how to create a set in a movie, how you enter in a space in a movie and immediately are in the opposite place, and how you travel a space into a movie without showing people traveling the spaces now. And I wanted to recreate this impression in my spaces, because I was thinking this is absolutely fantastic. And this is why the first, the main pole of the Banque Populaire at the beginning, that was named a dynamic space or traveling space, the place where you travel, the place where you move. And it's why, it's most of my space, I always want people to travel and to walk and not being static. I'm not in a person with contemplation. I love to move, I love to be in the movement, to go further, etc. So this is my dynamic, my internal dynamic in a way. So this is reflected in my building.
Thank you.
You have something that's a regular envelope and a very complex traveling inside, and which always has a sense about the movements of the body. It's never purely aesthetic. I mean, it always has a substance sense. But for the two living houses, it's different because they have oblique and completely outside and inside. It's almost the only projects where there's this.
Similarity between inside and outside?
Yes.
I never thought about that.
It's interesting because it gives it a very strong dynamic inside. Like for instance in Lyon, like the museum, well it's different, the museum in Rome, which is beautiful, but it's much more complex. But it's also almost regular surroundings. So you have this contrast.
You know why I did that
it,
for the macro?
Yes.
Not only because the story between
it's
because I did the competition in 2000, and I visited the Guggenheim in 1999.
Oh yes. Yeah.
So, because the Guggenheim has been built and finished in 1997, something like that. So when I went, I really wanted to visit the museum, the Guggenheim, in Bilbao. And I went there, and I started to walk into the building. And I discovered that after 7 hours, walking in every place, I had finished to travel into the museum. So I can have spent 7 hours traveling into the museum without never being in the same place, and having different perspectives, different point of view. And I said, my God, this is my dream. This is a dream for me to do that, to bring people to travel a space without being always in the same place, and being in the same perspective and the same position. And I was really, I spent 7 hours in that as the first time.
Yes, but
and it was really for me a big effect.
But there's also something quite different. The toilets where you create is infinity. You create some sort of infinity then when you're not mobile in some way. So that's another, that's a purely spatial and aesthetic intention, which is beautiful. And
I love my toilets. I always say that if you go to the museum, you have to visit the toilets. But it's true that I'm always in Newton, so.
Yes,
and you all know that.
Yes, and the boat also, very structured and also less real movement inside the boat.
Why would you like to work with wood? Don't you like to work with wood? And did you use burnt wood for the Davide in Condor? Did you use the Bovoli? Because it's black or?
It's not Bovoli. It's a specific bitum that is called the Swedish bitum, which is used to waterproof the wooden boat. And it's bad. Also, it's not bad. It's a bitum boat. And you have to repaint it every 2-3 days to have the waterproofing. Why do I don't build in wood? Because all the architects who are starting to build in wood were boring for me. And it's why, but at the same time, I love to work with structure. And from the very beginning, I love the precision of the steel structure, and I love the glass because I love the transformation of the glass as a material, because this is really where the innovation are coming all the time, constantly. Because we love to live in large surface of glass, and you have to be protected at the same time, so innovation are always in development. And I love that evolution, and I study that all the time. And rebuilding in wood could be the same as building in steel, but much bigger. When you do column in steel, this is like that. When you do column in wood, it's like that. In concrete, this is so. No. I love when everything is very precise and the connections are absolutely millimeters. And that because I love geometry. And for me, geometry, which is the second step after having doing a sketch, is to make it regulated by geometry. And I don't know why, but I love geometry. And I love making everything precisely correct, precisely connected, precisely designed. And with concrete, when you build in concrete, I remember one of my buildings in concrete for housing in Paris, a little one. I don't do that anymore. The wall was starting like that, and after that, when I start, it was 5 centimeters before, and after that, the second part was 5 feet. So it's not precise. Concrete is not precise. And it's precise by centimeters. And building in steel, the articulation has to be really precise. So this is why I do this. Because I love this position.
Donc c'est pas une question d'esthétique.
Non. I don't care about aesthetic, you know. I can't say that. Because I don't do something to be nice or to be beautiful. I discover at the end of my building that it's always a lot so bad. And because it's really, I don't do something for aesthetic. I have some less capacity to play with that, etc. But this is not my purpose. And it's the same when I start a project, usually I start by telling a story about how we will live inside, how we will behave inside, or will be inside. And the envelope is coming sometimes at the end, so very rarely at the beginning.
Speaking about aesthetic, you seem to be using color a lot in your projects in different like methods and ways. What's the significance for you? Significance for that, or how do you choose
because
your colors, or like what does it mean to you?
Just
joy.
My colors are joyful.
But what do you?
I have.
What do you? What's your inspiration?
I always have. I always have played with colors from the very beginning, in the 90s. But nobody knows because it was in two different degrees that I was there. But even the BPO was with some blue inside and pink inside, with Transbanker, it was but I started to use contrasted colors because I like the strong contrast between colors. And I'm not somebody who is using pastel colors. I'm not somebody who is using clear colors and faint colors. I know that colors are very saying that I'm pink, I'm yellow, I'm orange. And we started this collection of 12 colors that we use most of the time when we are doing a little restaurant in Paris. I think it's still there in the 17th arrondissement. It was all in black, and inside the tables were with 12 colors. And we decided by looking at some files and saying, oh, this color, we'll try this one, you know? And we make them together, we put them together, and it was working very well. This is how I saw that we can make white colors all together. And after that, we continue to work with these old colors. And you know that in the office, there is no other colors that you can use, except these 12 colors. And never brown. I don't know why. And a few green. But mostly the other one. Yeah. I don't like brown. Brown for me is not a color. But don't ask me the signification of that.
I just want to say a fun fact about the toilet, your toilet. In my country, everyone just wants to go to the toilet in the restaurant. And other places, that is really the red carpet in my country, like the toilet. Everyone just go there and take picture and go back just to say I was there, but...
Because the toilets are particular?
No, not really particular, but everyone can identify the toilet in the picture.
Oh,
so yeah,
nice.
I think you can be a star.
Okay, no problem. I don't care if it's a small project or this one. Another question? No? I'm sure that you will continue the next days. But I'll not be sad.